Good morning. My name is Dr. Atul Mohan Kochar and I am the CEO of NABH. So welcome to next in the series of NABH QCI webinar, which is our connect with the partner series. And today we have a glittering panel, some really good policymakers on the show today who are going to guide us through what is in store for healthcare of the nation. And we are very proud to be introducing in a while a glittering panel. But before that, let me introduce NABH and Quality Council of India. I'll just start sharing my screen. Without going into too much of the topic, we all know that quality assurance is all about patient safety, patient care, and everything which is preventing us from the harm. These are the broad principles of quality assurance: customer focus, leadership, engagement of people, process approach, improvement, evidence-based decision-making, and relationship management. So all these, we are not going to go into details of any of these, maybe at a later forum, but since all of us, and I've been told there's a huge number who has logged in to view this webinar, so these are the broad principles. We all know what is certification, what is accreditation, but broadly speaking, accreditation is an external review, which is governed by four principles. You know, written and published standards, reviews are conducted by professional peers and evaluated by an independent body. We have certification body, we have accreditation body. And our only aim is to encourage a safety culture across all our organizations. So this is the international ecosystem of quality, where we all know that ISO is very famous, then HACCP, then we have national standard, we have international standards, and all harmonized between testing, inspection. And so this is the broadly speaking, the ecosystem. And as far as the Indian is concerned, our international quality infrastructure dates back to 1947, when the Bureau of Indian Standards came into being. Quality Council of India, of which all of us are part, is a national accreditation body which was founded in 97 with different stakeholders. We have NPL and we have the Directorate of Legal Metrology also. And to come back to Quality Council of India, it was set up in 97 with the active participation of ASSOCHAM, CII and FICCI, and with the Government of India. All of the stakeholders, our chairman, Mr. Adil Zainul Bhai, he is appointed directly by the PMO. Our Secretary General, Dr. R.P. Singh, is a very hands-on person, and they govern different boards. We are an autonomous body under DPIIT, Ministry of Commerce. As far as the organization structure is concerned, we have a council, governing council, overseeing the governing body, then who is responsible for the Secretary General. And we have five boards, actually. NABCB, which takes care of the certification body, NABL, taking care of the labs, NABET, which is education and training, and a promotional board called National Board for Quality Promotion. We are the main board which takes care of the hospitals and healthcare provider, which means the NABH, besides the special projects group, which are there. All of our boards are affiliated and board members and positions of prominence across the international platform. For example, NABH is governed by ISQA, which is the International Society for Quality in Healthcare. These are all the government bodies where we have actively collaborated on so many projects, including Kayakalp, including COAL, Swachh Bharat, Yoga Day, everything. So these are the broad network of Quality Council of India projects where we actively collaborate with the body. So as far as NABH is concerned, we are currently running about 16 programs, which range across accreditation, certification, empanelment, and there are currently, these are only, if we were to include all the partner institutions, we know we are touching nearly 9,000 currently. And this includes Ayush hospitals, medical imaging. Besides the hospital, the main hospital, we have a huge network of certified, empaneled, and accredited agencies. And our NABL has done us very, very proud recently by working overtime to accredit and enhance the capacity of reverse transcriptase PCR assays and cross-country. And they worked hand-in-hand with Government of India and ICMR to build up a large ecosystem. So this is just a brief introduction. And coming back to the main focus today, our main topic for today is, I'll just introduce just a minute. Our main topic today is importance of quality certification in changing the culture of healthcare. So actually, we are amidst a crisis, and during such a crisis, it is very easy. There may be some people who would like to question the relevance of accreditation, maybe question the relevance of such regulatory methods, which they conceive to be regulatory or licensure. What is the relevance? What is the importance? But it is my only submission that it's only because of such SOPs, it is only because of such culture, it is only because of just a minute. I've been told that it is only because of such culture. It's only because of such ecosystem. It's only because of such protocols, our standards, that we have been able to deal with such a crisis in such a structured manner. To all those, I can also say that these guidelines we have been able to adhere with only because of we had NABH, only because we have a Quality Council of India, and we already were following such processes. To come back to our panel, we have a very, very senior, very accomplished and astute administrators, who's also a wonderful and much awarded doctor. And I would like to introduce today to give his view on the policy of the a major program. It's the worldwide, the largest program in the world, Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. We welcome you, sir, Dr. Vipul Agarwal, who is the Deputy CEO. And for his complete introduction, I cannot just pass him over. Dr. Vipul Agarwal is not only a senior police officer, a serving IPS officer of 2001 Gujarat Cadre. He's a medical doctor turned a cop from Maulana Azad Medical College. He was the class topper for class 10th. He graduated with much awards and laurels from the Sardar Vallabhbhai National Police Academy. He won distinction in forensic medicine. And he also won the coveted Home Minister's Revolver and PM's Baton for Best All-Round Officer Trainee. He is a committed knowledge seeker. Dr. Vipul Agarwal has several diplomas and degrees under his belt, to name a few. He has a master's degree in police management from Osmania University, a master's degree in English literature, a master's degree in business admin from IGNOU, and is currently pursuing PhD in human resource management from Gujarat University. So as a visionary officer and a change driver, Dr. Agarwal is accustomed to overcoming numerous and seemingly impossible challenges. He was the superintendent of police of Porbandar, Banasakantha, and the Dahod district. And he was also the joint commissioner of police, Ahmedabad city. He is not new to administration of medical, and he has held responsibilities of MD of NRHM in Gujarat State Health Department and Gujarat Medical Services Corporation Limited, which I can say from experience is one of the best run medical administration department of any state. So welcome, Dr. Vipul Agarwal. We are so proud to have you here with us, sir. And I'll request you to please guide us. What is the way forward for PMYJ? And what is the way forward for this massive program? What is in store for the healthcare culture of India as a country? Welcome, please, once again.
Thank you, Dr. Kocher, for the introduction. It is a moment of pleasure to have been invited in this August forum and be given a chance to share the scheme structure and other details with the participants. As I've been told, it's a huge gathering, almost 1500 registrations, that indeed speaks about the kind of enthusiasm you have in your team and the kind of motivation NABH and the Quality Council has among these cadres across the country. I really congratulate you for all the efforts. So I am here to speak about one of the most ambitious and prestigious projects of Government of India in recent times, the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, or the ABPMJ. Incidentally, it also, as Dr. Kochar mentioned, is the biggest, largest health insurance project across the globe. Run by any public sector unit. So it is the government-run biggest project with more than 500 million beneficiaries. Ayushman Bharat has its two components. One is the Jan Arogya Yojana, ABPMJ, that we are running, and another project component is Ayushman Bharat Health and Wellness Centers. So the health and wellness centers are directly run by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, whereas the ABPMJ, a special body at the center, which is now a statutory authority, NHA, National Health Authority, is taking up the project. So this is very unique in its functioning, as it has both a policy formulation as well as implementation roles. So it is, although a unit working under the ministry, at the same time it is it has got all the autonomy to implement this project, to formulate policy, and it for all purposes is governed by a board, and we are answerable to the board and not to directly to the ministry as such. So we have 11 membered governing board, where incidentally the Minister of Health and Family Welfare is our honorable chairman, and the Secretary of Health and Family Welfare is one of the members. So we, can you upload the presentation, please? So Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana is overall headed by a chief executive officer, and I play my role as deputy CEO implementing the project. Next, please. So coming to the background of this scheme was launched as a byproduct of the National Health Policy 2017 recommendations, when it was felt that India needs a strong universal healthcare and health for all scheme, which encompasses all the issues and takes care of whatever flaws we had at that time identified regarding the healthcare implementation in the country. So the scheme formulators that time came across and found out that in the country we had basically five different areas which needed to be targeted. One was that the basic 20%, more than 20% of the population was below poverty line, having less than $1.9 earnings per day, which was too low to take care of the healthcare needs. At the same time, the population was challenged by a triple burden. So we traditionally have been, because of low sanitation and poverty, the non-communicable diseases, the communicable diseases like infectious diseases being there in the society as a whole. At the same time, we were being burdened to a great extent by non-communicable diseases, which had a long-lasting and lifelong financial impact on the population. At the same time, the mother and child health related issues were also becoming more and more important and consuming a lot, large part of budget from the, and it was leading to poverty, increase in poverty in the populace. Then the lack of affordable healthcare, especially in the public sector. It was found that more than 70% of the institutes which are there in the country are run by the private sector, and the public sector capacities were not adequate to take care of that. So we needed a framework which could encourage the private public sector to match up to the private sector. At the same time, we need to augment our capacities. This was one issue which was identified. Then OOPE, out-of-pocket expenditure. It was found that more than 60% of the expenditure on the healthcare was out-of-pocket, leading to more than 6 crore people going below the poverty line every year, which was a major reason in increasing the poverty and hitting the poverty alleviation program. So we needed to target the this issue by a comprehensive healthcare scheme which could take care of the needs of the bottom 40% of the population. Then the final issue which was identified was large population of India is migrant laborers and poor people who go out of their states for working. So if the states have implemented a particular healthcare scheme, they were not being able to take advantage of it outside the state. So this portability feature was not lacking in the state schemes, which was causing difficulties in the implementation and reaching out to the public. Next, please. So the under ABPMJ, we utilized the readily available 2011 socioeconomic caste sensor based data, and we pulled out bottom 40% population based on rural deprivation criteria and urban occupational criteria. So the SECC data gave us D1 to D7 categories in terms of deprivation in the rural population. At the same time, there was another scheme running, Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana, which was Ministry of Labour and Employment scheme. So all the beneficiaries were automatically covered as on 28th of February 2018. Whosoever was a beneficiary of RSBY was automatically made a part of this scheme. And the people identified on the basis of SECC data on socioeconomic caste sensor deprivation and occupational criteria were included. So 53.7 crore people, which forms almost 40% of the bottom 40% of the population, including 10.74 crore families, were automatically included in the scheme. And it is basically a entitlement based scheme. Nobody has to enroll for it. They're already entitled to take the benefit. They just need to find out whether they are beneficiaries or not. Each family covered under this scheme, and a family is not the term, actually we use household, which might include more than one family. So each household has a cover of 5 lakh rupees on a family floater basis. So meaning by that, every family member, one member can avail this 5 lakh benefit, or multiple members of the family can in total avail a benefit of up to 5 lakh rupees of insurance cover in a year. The benefits of this scheme are portable across all the 1.5 thousand hospitals that we have. So as on date, we have 21,500, including around 9,000 government private sector hospitals. So this is another is a major achievement that we have not been able to so far in the previous schemes garner the support of private sector involvement in healthcare needs. This is the first scheme of its kind, which involves private sector, and that too to such a great extent that we have almost 46% participation from private sector, and 9,600 hospitals from private sector are participants and empaneled hospitals as on date. Plus RSBY had a family cap of 5 persons per family, whereas this scheme, because of the issues which were found in the family size related aspects, we have removed the cap on family size, age or gender, and even the pre-existing diseases. So all people, it might be, although there have been cases wherein this family capping, non-capping on the family has led to some issues, but those are being subsequently taken care by making the norms a bit more stringent, but still there is no size upper limit on the number of members in a family in the scheme. Next, please. Now, so understanding the ecosystem, how this scheme is being operationalized. So we proudly claim to have got the best of its kind IT platform in the country, anywhere in the government sector, and it is the state of the art. So we have a three-layer system wherein there's a payer, there's a hospital, which is EHCP, we call empaneled healthcare provider, and the beneficiary. So this is the payer. We have a structure wherein National Health Authority is the apex body. Then we have state health agencies. The state health agency is headed by a secretary rank officer who's the CEO of the state health agency. And there's an insurer. So in cases so as we can see in the right side of the slide, the scheme is run on three modes. One is the states, which can run it on their own on the trust model, wherein the trusts have been formed or the state health agencies are running it. It is called the trust mode. In cases where the state has given it through tender arrangement to some private insurance agency, so that is called the insurance model. And there's a mixed model in place wherein both are working in tandem to implement the project. So the insurer would come into play. Insurer can be the state, which is normally termed as an assurance scheme, or the insurer could be a private insurance company. Regarding the hospitals, as I have already mentioned, the public and private hospital network running across the country, except for three states, and the fourth state, Delhi, is going to be a partner very soon. So barring three states, all the other states are our partners now. As we can see on the right side of the slide, previous slide, please. Yeah, so apart from that, we have a strong capacity building, monitoring and evaluation framework wherein we keep giving training and learning and management platform is operational, wherein we keep conducting courses, keep assessing the training or manpower or capacity requirements of the state and keep augmenting their capacities accordingly. We have a robust grievance redressal and call center system in place, wherein around 700 call center operatives sitting in four cities are addressing the grievances, and we are having a toll-free number of 14555 on which the beneficiary can not only understand whether he is entitled to the scheme benefits, he can register his grievances also, and he can get redressal on those. Then we have a very, very robust fraud prevention framework. So in fact, the fraud analytics and machine learning tools that we are developing might be one of their kind in the world. And we have the best agency probably considered on analytics, that is the SAS. It is implementing the project, which is FACTS. We term that portal as FACTS portal, and that would be helping the states in due course. So it is in the stage of launching now, and we would be launching by the end of this month. And after this framework is implemented, our fraud and abuse prevention would get a major boost. Then as Dr. Meena would be addressing the gathering in due course, the quality assurance system and the quality assurance framework on bronze, gold and silver that we have launched in August last year is another a tool to improve the quality of healthcare that we are providing, and then we are issuing guidelines from time to time. As we can see on the right side of the slide, the shaded portion on can be identified. We have the trust mode in running in 20 city states. Four states are having mixed mode, and eight states are on insurance modes. Whereas one state, Delhi, we are in the process of signing the MOU, and the mode of implementation would be decided as per the state's requirement. Next, please. So what happens when a beneficiary, first of all, how the beneficiary gets to know whether he's entitled to the scheme or not. So beneficiary identification BIS system is a very sophisticated tool that we have developed, wherein the data can be pulled through SECC data, which is already available in the database. The beneficiary can, whenever it's, so the common services centers available in the villages, rural areas, or the hospitals and panel hospitals, the beneficiary can go to any of these and show his personal identifier and the family identifier. For example, if he's having his Aadhaar card and his ration card for his as a family identifier, he can go to the kiosk, and then within 6 to 8 hours his identification and registration is done and e-card is issued. So if a patient does not have a e-card in hand and he goes to the hospital with these two identifiers, very prompt and very fast registration process is taken and he is immediately hospitalized, wherein a pre-authorization request is placed to the state's insurance or assurance agency. And from there, approvals instantly come and the treatment starts. So upon the completion of treatment, the discharge summary is prepared and the claim related documents are uploaded. So the entire process is paperless. So there's no paper involved at any stage of transactions, and the entire claim processing, settlement of dues, which the entire cycle maximum takes 10 to 15 days, is completed. And in case of portability, it maximum takes 1 month. So the entire cycle gets completed very promptly and in a very efficient manner. Next, please. Yeah, so regarding the health benefit packages, this is for the participants of this group who are belonging to various hospitals. So we would like to encourage all to be a member of this scheme. This scheme earlier was having an HBP1, first generation of health benefit packages. We used to have 1393 packages in place, which have been recently replaced by a different revised structure of HBP 2.0. wherein we have split the packages and procedures into 872 packages and 1578 procedures. So So all the issues that we were having with the package implementation and the rationalization exercises, so that have been completed. And now the packages are more in tune with the market demand. And lots of issues which were causing abuses or irregularities, they have been taken care of. The packages include 1,083 surgical packages, 309 medical packages. And as we had in RSVY, there is an unspecified package of up to 1 lakh rupees. This is only used in case of surgical packages. So the where the package thing is not defined and the patient comes and it is felt that this needs to be booked in the unspecified package, the hospital can raise a pre-auth under unspecified, up to 1 lakh amount can be reimbursed. As we can see on the bottom right, we have some incentive packages also in place to encourage and to take care of the extra expenditures as per the demands of A1 A-class cities. For example, A-class cities get a 10% incentive. Similarly, aspirational districts, we are giving 10% benefit. Entry-level NABH, which we call as a silver certification. So that we are giving 10% incentive, and gold certificate or full NABH, we are giving 15% incentive. Finally, the institutes running PG or DNB course again are entitled to a 10% benefit under the scheme, advantage over and above the normal package rate in the scheme. Next, please. So coming to the other features of health benefit packages and how the expenses are incurred and booked. So normally in the scheme, 60% of the expenses are taken care by NHA. So NHA jo hai wo 60% total kharche mein se lagbhag tamam states ke 60% kharcha jo ho raha hai wo NHA le raha hai aur 40% states incur kar rahe hain. Whereas in case of union territories and hilly regions, ye jo kharcha hai wo 90 aur 10 डिवाइडेड है और जिन इसमें जिन यूनियन टेरिटरीज में लेजिस्लेचर नहीं है उधर 100% एक्सपेंस आर बीइंग टेकन केयर बाय एनएचए. सो एज आई हैड ऑलरेडी मेंशन दैट क्लेम सेटलमेंट टेक्स एनीवेयर बिटवीन 15 टू 30 डेज. और ये जो पैकेज है हमारी पैकेज, अनलाइक द सीजीएचएस पैकेजेस, हमारी पैकेज में सब कुछ इंक्लूडेड है. 3 दिन प्री हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन टू 15 डेज पोस्ट हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन, मेडिसिन, टेस्टिंग, व्हाटएवर इज इंक्लूडेड, इट इज ऑल इंक्लूसिव. So whether it is implant cost, whether it is any procedure which has to be performed, any test which has to be performed, MRI, everything has been taken, counted in the packages. And 3 days pre-hospitalization up to 15 days post-hospitalization treatment and medicines, everything is included in our package rate. So the patient does not have to spend anything from his pocket while he's coming to our hospital, and paperless transactions take place. Then NHA has recently started exercise of mapping the packages into standard treatment workflows. So we have already completed drafting of 120 standard treatment workflows corresponding to around 400 packages. And I think within the next 2 months, all these would be integrated with the IT system and the entire process of treatment would become simplified. Everybody would be knowing which medicine has to be used. So doctors would have a standard template to act on, and we would also get to know whether our packages, in any case, once these STWs are in place, we can further go on rationalizing the packages in case we see requests that the packages are not still as per the requirements and the financials are not properly worked out by us. So we are continuously improving ourselves, and the best thing is that NHA has got the authority and the prompt processes to immediately react and act on the state's request regarding various issues that they are facing. Next, please. As I mentioned, NHA, I think of all the government sector agencies, has got the kind of framework that we are developing might be one of its best, and we have studied US and other countries' models also. So the advanced artificial intelligence and machine learning tools being developed by us would be state of the art. And already we have a radar software working for us, wherein we have identified 1,42,000 suspect T cards, which were pushed into the states, and states have already taken action on 87,000. So the kind of cards for suspect transaction that we are pulling, almost 70%, 80% compliance is coming out from the states. At the same time, we have we have three components of our IT system. One is the hospital empanelment module, second is the beneficiary identification, and third is transaction management system. So all three different modules, we take out the suspect transactions relating to transaction management. We have come out with 26,884 suspect transactions so far, of which 5,621 have been identified by states to be prima facie abuse, and we are taking strong action against the hospitals of up to DM panelment and registration of FIRs. Next, please. So as I mentioned, hospitals, almost 205 hospitals have been DM paneled, 6 FIRs have been launched. We have recovered up to 5.46 crore rupees, and the PMAM is Pradhan Mantri Arogya Mitra, who basically is at the field level for registration of and acting as the first line of contact with the beneficiary. So deactivation of PMAMs or Common Service Center village level entrepreneur accounts in 7,727 cases. Next, please. So I would like to convey to the audience the kind of speed at which an ABPMJ has been launched. I must tell you that if you get a chance, you visit our headquarters. It is quite unlike a government sector scheme. We have around 200 people working in the headquarters, which belong to around 12 different organizations. And each resource that we have has been handpicked and probably the best in the industry. And we work on proper time frame bound actions, and you can analyze and appreciate the kind of speed which we have acted. 1st February 18, the scheme design was thought of. In fact, we got approval in January 2018 from the cabinet. The cabinet approval came on January 18. 1st February, scheme design was ready. 21st March, in fact, 1st February to 21st March, 2 months we took, 1.5 months we took for scheme, making the scheme design ready. Another 2 months, less than 2 months, we entered into MOU with 5 states with policy guidelines, IT system, everything was put in place in 1.5 months. On 15th August, we ran a pilot and we activated the scheme. So the scheme launch took place on 23rd September 18 with all things coming in place. I don't think that schemes of this magnitude can be implemented so fast. It was just because of the vision the government had, Honorable Prime Minister, and the entire system was so supportive that from 1st February till 23rd September, we already had everything in place. And after that, everything is history. If you see that scheme was rolled out in 22 states on 23rd September, March 2019, already we had 14.96 lakhs beneficiaries and 7.5 crore e-cards, which now as on date is 12.46 crore e-cards we have as on date. So in September 19, it reached 10 crores. And day four yesterday, we achieved the milestone of 1 crore plus treatment. So it has been a dream which we are living and are continuously achieving milestones after milestone just because of the extremely dedicated lot of people that we have assisting us and the kind of enthusiasm we have in our ground staff, including the hospitals and the field level staff who are running this project. Next, please. So the few of the highlights, 12.45 crore beneficiaries verified, almost 13,400 crores we have already spent on this scheme with 1 crore plus hospitalizations. 21,564 hospitals, I said, have already been empaneled, and 1.5 lakh portability cases worth rupees 248 crore that we have handled. We term is that as our big achievement because portability issues are so difficult to handle, and they were an impossible thing to think of even when we conceived the scheme, but this has been made a reality. Next, please. I'll just touch upon the quality certification because there's a separate session on that. So we thought that when we are running the scheme of this magnitude and prestige, unless we have some quality parameters attached to it, the scheme might not achieve the kind of results that we expect out of it. So this was thought of as a essential component of the scheme, and in with all the effort that we made and the support we got from NABH Quality Council of India, in August 2019, we launched the ABPMJ quality certification process. And we had 3 levels of quality certification in this, bronze certificate, then silver was NABH entry level, and gold was NABH full NABH accreditation. And as on date, we have 141 hospitals who are quality certified, including 64 gold certificate. We have a long way still to go. And I would request all the participants to kindly keep guiding us, suggesting us, and be a partner in this process, because this is going to be the game changer. Ultimately, if we are able to bring the treatment standards to international level, this is the program which is going to assist us in that. And I've already mentioned that 15% incentive is given to the gold level and 10% to the silver certified hospitals. Next, please. So in the concluding things, I would dwell a little bit on the call center thing. So our call center 14555 was launched almost a year and a half back, and it is running in 4 states, Bangalore, Hyderabad, Calcutta, and Delhi. So we have around 700 call center operators, and we have recently during this COVID crisis assisted the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare running the 1075. So 1075 helpline also is being run by our call centers only, taking the support of few pro bono operators who have assisted us. And as of now, we have capacities up to 1500 call center operators, augmentation done through private sector support. And we have received 6 lakhs plus calls, and we are pushing these calls and the grievances to the states as and when we receive some requests. So we are receiving the feedback also, and the feedback management system also has been made very comprehensive. And we have linked it to our assessment system, and in the due course, we would be sending interactive SMS is also to our beneficiaries, whosoever makes a phone call, so that we get an assessment on the actual experience with our call centers. So far, the experience on very good experience has been 53% and good has been 42%. Next, please. So finally, our little bit effort that we could make and contribute towards this current crisis. So when the COVID-19 pandemic was declared, and NHA proactively launched the testing and treatment packages for COVID. So we were having already packages running for SARI and ILI. SARI means severe acute respiratory illness and influenza-like illness. So apart from these 5, we launched the COVID-19 packages and gave flexibility to the states to fix their package rates. And we also started the process of allowing the hospitals, our empaneled hospitals, to get into arrangement with the ICMR registered labs for getting a free testing done for the COVID patients. So now we are reimbursing 100% to the healthcare institutes on all the tests which are being done for COVID-19 patients. At the same time, we recently have launched the process of empaneling labs directly, so that if our hospitals refer a patient to a lab, the labs can directly be reimbursed by us. So that also has been launched. Then we also thought of simplifying the process of hospital empanelment by launching an HEM Lite module on our website. So far, 1,010 approximately hospitals have been added in the last 1.5 months. I think from 1st April till date, more than 1,010 hospitals have already been enrolled under this scheme. And we have also booked enrolled standalone dialysis center, because what we experienced was, because of the COVID crisis and turning of hospitals into COVID only facilities, dialysis patients and the patients who required repeated treatments were not being able to be catered properly. So we augmented the capacities by booking the standalone dialysis center, registering them under the scheme. Then we are feeding the PMO and higher offices on SARI and ILI cases, because we have an advanced data analytics team in place. So these charts and dashboards are being shared with all the policymakers, and implementation of latest guidelines are coming, wherein NHA is providing its role. And we have placed almost 30 million calls to PMJ high-risk beneficiaries by IVRS advisories. So these advisories have been launched after COVID crisis, and we have identified high-risk beneficiaries, and through our call centers, these and cloud server, we are making cloud telephony and calls being placed to all the high-risk beneficiaries to give them advice on the precautions that they have to take. Then we are providing Arogya Setu, this app which was launched by Ministry of Information and Technology. NHA is providing the teleconsultation platform for Arogya Setu. As I've already mentioned, and 1075 COVID helpline support is being provided. And recently we have entered into arrangement with Ola and Uber to provide transport services to healthcare workers who were not being able to reach to their place of work. So completely sanitized atmosphere, they can hire the cab and go, for which NHA has entered into an MOU with these cab providers. Next, please. So that was it. I would now request Dr. Kochar and team and other participants to kindly let me know if there are any queries. Thank you very much for giving me a chance to speak and interact with you. Thank you.
Dr. Vipul, I think that's a really articulate and really, hello, am I audible?
Yes, Dr.
Dr. Vipul, yes. I think that's, thank you so much for a really wonderful, articulate and very coherent presentation of such a complex scheme. And this is, this I'm sure the health benefit package you just mentioned, I mean, is going to have far reaching changes. And just a liner that on behalf of QCI and NABH, we are really proud to be associated with NHA in any capacity. And we'll continue to assure 100% support to this great game-changing scheme. There are so many questions which reached us. One of them is that the health package one, and most of you have already addressed actually, you know, so health benefit package two, which is more comprehensive, covering more disorders, more logical. So, one of the grievances of our partners across private sector was that they were not finding it financially viable. So I think you've already addressed it, but would you like to elaborate more that how the costing part has been taken care of in this thing?
Yeah, so we had a 23-membered expert panel which assisted and guided us from ICMR. So we did an assessment of the entire gamut of various packages that we had and the various problems we were facing. It was found out that few of the packages were not rational. Second, there was a lot of duplication in the packages. Then there were cases wherein, for example, if an implant has to be placed, one implant, four implant, five implant, there was no specification as to whether single implant would be costing how much. So we have separated the implant cost as a separate procedure. That would be an add-on thing that we have added so that if a number of implants is more, then accordingly, the cost can be done. Then stratification of the packages was not allowed. Then one package or one procedure was a part of multiple specialties, but this was being shown in all specialties and with, in some cases, different rates. So we have rationalized it, and a few packages which are common to various specialties have been now separated as a, and any specialty can pick that. So apart from that, regarding the rates, the issues that we were having, we have given a cap of 110% increase on the cost of packages vis-a-vis the HBP 1.0. So up to 110% increase. So if it was 100 rupees, we have increased by 10 rupees based on a general idea and general assessment that we did. There were around 400-500 area things wherein we had to reduce the cost of package also based on the expert study. So now, as we understand and as the requests keep coming, we are getting to know that the packages are much more in tune with the market. There are still some issues. We might come out with HBP 2.1 in due course. But at the same time, most of the states have welcomed this move, and most of the private sector hospitals also have accepted in a much positive manner, because earlier when the scheme was launched, we had very little time. So whatever data we had available, whatever we could do in short time, we had to do. But now that the scheme is slightly stabilized, we can experiment more and we can come out with better and realistic figures. And that is an effort in that direction. We might not be 100% perfect, but I think in due course, with the support of the EHCPs, we would definitely rationalize and keep evolving as the scheme grows.
Wonderful. Is there, sir, a provision for sequential procedures also? I mean, because healthcare sometime may not be a one-time initiative. I mean, maybe there are operations, maybe there are diseases which have to be taken care of in a sequential manner. So is that issue also addressed by HBP2?
100%. Sequential procedures, as in, for example, if some person is of dialysis, you want to say, yes, that every month he has to come. One is that. One second is scenario wherein a patient is on the hospital bed and some other disease is found out in that person. So a pre-auth can be raised during the treatment also. So as a subsequent step, the sequential packages can be booked by raising a separate pre-auth. At the same time, if the patient is discharged and later on he comes for the same treatment, some procedures have been allowed to be taken up as sequential procedure, whereas some are blocked. If one surgery has taken place, for example, somebody has already had cataract surgery, the second time he cannot have it. So some procedures have been blocked for sequential things and some have been allowed. So that provision has been made in the recent change that we have done.
In the COVID scenario, you already announced a whole lot of activities, and we are so proud that despite the lockdown, despite all restriction and crisis, NHAS continued to be on its path of enlarging the scheme even during these last 2 months of crisis. So do you see the schemes or the timelines being changed in the current scenario? I mean, going forward in the future, and any changes you feel may need to be incorporated into the execution part, the implementation part, or for the large number of NCDs, the non-communicable disease you touched on in the first part, or the wellness part, I mean, though that is being taken care of by the Health Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So do you see any policy changes as part of the COVID crisis?
Yeah, so as I mentioned in my presentation also, what has happened after the COVID thing is that this infection, once a hospital gets into a COVID-only facility, it becomes next to impossible to take up other patients. Now, what happens is the patients like cancer, patients requiring hemodialysis, who require treatment on a continuous basis on month-on-month, so those are suffering, and because most of the hospitals that we have with us are less than 50 beds. So what we have seen during the recent times is more than 50-60% hospitals have closed down because of the kind of stigma that is attached because of turning into a COVID only facility. The patient, other patients stay away from the hospital. So what we are encouraging now is non-COVID facilities also should get registered with us so that we develop capacities as an alternative. But which are taken over by the government to compensate for the reduced capacities. So the other hospitals, healthcare institutes, which are supporting in non-COVID related treatments, which are chronic nature, which require repeated treatment, we are encouraging them. And this hospital, HEM Light, has shown encouraging response from such hospitals. In fact, in the earlier part of our COVID crisis, we saw that the pre-auths had reduced by 85%. And we were just reduced to 15% of the normal routine pre-authorization that we used to have. And now it is almost reached 40% of the pre-auths. And I think with the lockdown opening, it might increase also. But what I want to say is that we are making a proactive effort. And as and when the new guidelines keep coming from ICMR, we keep circulating and adjusting our policies according to that. It is an ever-changing scenario. It is a new kind of challenge. We also do not know how the things will turn out, but the scientists and our ICMR and other policymakers are giving us guidance on the various protocols which are coming to the fore, and we are accordingly making changes day in, day out. So we've already issued almost 5 office memorandum in tune with the demands of time, and as and when the situation keeps changing, we would adjust and we would maneuver our policies and adjust them to the tune of time.
One last question, Dr. Vipul, and this is a personal question actually. Medical doctor also, you are an astute administrator also, and you are a police officer also. So that's why I think I looked at interest. I mean, the stern warning you gave out to all those fraudsters and other people, I think you are uniquely placed to be in the seat. So when you are sitting, so which form takes over actually? Is it all or, how do you wish to address one last warning to all those who might wish to abuse this scheme or whatever?
Yeah, I feel that things are not that bad. I am always a doctor by heart, and I think that temperament of a doctor carries with you all through all 18 years that I worked on the field. I always had that temperament, and that is never going to go. But having said that, I would like to say that this fraud abuse, although we have incorporated, this is just to be used in exceptional circumstances. Our experience is that people across the country are, and especially this medical fraternity, things are not that bad. It might be 10, 15, 20% issues, but 80% are self-disciplined and motivated to work and contribute to a cause. The basic tools that we have developed are to take care of situation where it acts as a deterrence rather than we needing to take some action against them, and that is never our intention. We are running this scheme and we cannot run this scheme unless the field level institute support us. And I feel that all these machine tools and other things are only to give a deterrent effect. But without these also, I think in 80-85% cases, no frauds would take place, because I found this is as one of the most noble and cleanest of the professions. And as our experience also is that those who are into good practices are always into good practices. It is only a few black sheep who are trying to turn the broth bad. And we would like to definitely take action, but at the same time, action is not our incentive, is our main motivating thing. We would like a scenario to come wherein more and more institutes join us, the scheme gets a wider acceptability, and all these issues of fraud, abuse, etc. just do not come to our fore, and a clean and very healthy atmosphere is created, and all of us have to work it. And what a team who is so committed to work, and we get forums like this to talk to other people also and spread across the message. Thank you so much for that.
I think that's a most wonderful and positive message for all of us. There are tens of more questions actually. Are Ayush medicines covered in PMJA? Do NHA, does NHA plan to give any incentive to bronze quality certified hospital like Silver Gold?
I would like to answer that. Yeah, so
please.
Even if you don't want to give that question to me.
No, it's all yours, actually. Basically. It's only because of, like you said initially, the time constraint. But there's one more question. Is there any vision of clubbing the state health scheme like Arogya Shri with PMJ, which are same in the process and also the criteria of beneficiary? So Ayush medicines covered in PMJ.
See, Ayush is a difficult issue to address. That is a policy call to be taken at the governing board and the government level at large. We would support whatever decision is taken. But speaking about the conversion, that is a very important thing, because our major objective is that multiplication and double dipping of schemes wherein the patient is getting advantage of more than one scheme. The databases are not synced. Many of our scheme related beneficiaries who actually should get the benefit are out of the scheme because we are using SECC database. So ultimately, one common database which is all comprehensive, all inclusive, and all states conforming to one guideline and single uniform healthcare insurance government sector scheme. That is our ultimate objective, and we are getting more and more support from the states. Few states have been the brownfield states having traditional schemes running, wherein they are giving advantages to their citizens, which are much above what we can take, because we have to think about the country as a whole. So we are trying to negotiate with the states and get into an arrangement where such aberrations or such packages wherein they are giving abnormally high or abnormally low rates are taken out and some consensus is evolved. So that is our ultimate effort. We are into arrangement with other ministries, Ministry of Road Surface and Transport, MORTH, and then Ministry of Home Affairs, Ministry, and then Universal Healthcare in Union Territories. So we are in consultation with various ministries, and scheme convergence is going to take place in a very short period of time. And our ultimate objective is that all government healthcare schemes should merge into one. So if NHA can provide that platform, that is our ultimate objective. And definitely state schemes, we would like to ensure that all the states come into a our IT platforms run a single country, so that we become a country as a whole, and the aberrations can be reduced to as low as possible. Coming to the quality certification, the basic objective when we made a beginning was only to have some incentive to go for quality. At the same time, we have not been able to address what to do with the bronze certification. So this was thought of as to what should be the bronze certification, be the next stage to incentivize the hospitals who have got the bronze certification. So first thing that we have The positive direction, and they are being incentivized for that. So now no concrete thing has been decided so far, but definitely in due course we would like a situation to come wherein 100% of our hospitals are at least BRONE certified, and those who are not should definitely be disincentivized or DM panel. So that is our objective. Thank you
so much, sir. I think that is really wonderful, comprehensive presentation. And with your permission, we would like to place for all those who joined us late the entire presentation and a recording of this chat show or webinar on our website also, which we normally do. I think lots more can benefit and continue to see and learn from your vision and learn from the vision of the scheme, actually. So I think NHSA is the massive scheme, and again, Quality Council of India and NABH will be proud to partner in any initiative, whether it's a wellness initiative, whether it's continuing gold, silver, bronze. I mean, we would be honored and privileged to continue to work hand in hand in this vision. So thank you so much. And we really appreciate your taking time to address this large gathering, and despite your such a busy schedule. And thank you so much. Thank you. And we would take up your invitation to come and visit the office, and we'll pass it on to all stakeholders and see for themselves. I would encourage all those who would wish to partner with NHA in any capacity to visit and see for themselves the good, such good being done at close range. So thank you so much, sir. Namaskar. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thanks very much.
Thank you. So coming back to our next panelist, we have with us today Dr. J.L. Meena. Dr. J.L. Meena needs no introduction. He's not only a close friend, but he is a senior principal assessor of NABH also. And please allow me to share my screen for a brief introduction, because he is again worthy. He comes with a rich experience of 17 years of which 15 years he has worked with Gujarat government. He was the state quality officer for Gujarat. Then he took over as general manager of National Health Authority, where he's looking after spreading the word of quality assurance. Just a minute, sir. Dr. Meena, are you with us?
Yes, sir.
Is the screen visible?
Yeah, visible, sir.
Correct. So he's Dr. Jitulal Meena is a MBBS and MBA also, with a whole lot of string of degrees. And he's presently working as a general manager with the responsible for quality networking and quality assurance, National Health Authority. A part of the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. He is working in quality healthcare since 2002. He's traveled to and has huge exposure of Johns Hopkins. Dr. Meena recently took new initiative with the help of QCI for implementation of bronze, silver and gold. And we are actively partnering with you, sir. And Dr. Meena led to prepare the quality standards in reproductive and child health, RCH, Kayakalp. He is a much awarded Quality Achiever Award and a whole lot of assessments under his belt. So we are proud to have you with us, Dr. Meena. And we are looking forward to learning from you and our whole gathering, which is here today, how simplified the procedure you have made, and how you've improved your TAT turnaround time, and there are no bureaucratic hassles now for empanelment. So please share with us your expertise and how easy it is to get empaneled under NHA. Okay.
Yes, sir. Good morning to everybody. First of all, I heartily congratulations to NABH and QCI for organizing this wonderful workshop. And I also heartily congratulations to our Deputy CEO for excellent presentations. I think so. When we say for the quality, a general definition of the quality is the right work at the right time for the right client by the right provider with the affordable cost is known as the quality. But when we say for the quality in the health sectors, the standard environment include the infrastructure, include the manpowers, include the instrument equipment, include trainings. But if everything is available, but behavior is not proper, then again is the big issue. And last but not least, the satisfaction for both provider as well as client. But the simple definition of the quality is that jo aapko chahiye wo dusron ko do, that means quality. If you are the patient, what is your expectation? So very simple definition, jo aapko chahiye wo dusron ko do, that means quality. And when we say for the quality coming from your heart, it's never achieved by any force. It's coming from your heart. When you feel the quality from your heart, you will give the quality to the patients or others. And important one thing, if God cannot think for quality, then the DNA between the chimpanzee and human beings, only 1% difference. So if God cannot think for quality, we all are chimpanzee. So that's why the Ayushman Bharat is also think for the quality. And quality is the teamwork. It's never achieved by a single person. If surgeon do best surgery, but his nursing staff is not proper, you cannot prevent the infections. Housekeeping is not proper, you can't prevent infection. If pharmacist is not proper, you cannot cure. So that's it's the teamwork. And the simple, very important is the quality, again, is the continuous process. It's the endless process. And that's why the Ayushman Bharat is think for the quality with the help of the Quality Council of India and prepared our presentations. Especially just for I share my presentations of the bronze, silver and quality certifications. Just for a minute. I think this is. Are you see the, yeah, the NHA with the help of the Quality Council of India, we plan for the quality certifications for the continuous quality improvements, the silver, gold and bronze quality certifications. You see, this is the bronze quality. Why we need the bronze quality certification? Because we have the tier 2 and tier 3 cities where the very difficult to implement the NABH and others. So it's a very lower level quality certifications of the bronze quality, which is required basic requirement for the infrastructures, for the manpower, for training, some legal environments, and create the quality cultures. That's why with the help of the Quality Council of India, we need the bronze quality certifications. The important thing is for the bronze, silver, and gold quality certification, all the certificates are paperless certificates. It's totally online. And we mainly focus on the self-assessment because when we say for the quality, I think self-assessment is the best assessment for the improvement because you know that your strength, you know your weakness, you know your opportunity, and you know your threats. Agar dusra mere ko kuch batayega ki tumhare mein ye kami hai, to ek inferiority complex ho jayega. Lekin if your self-assessment is best, you know that mere mein ye kami hai, to ek improvement ki opportunity aapko mil jayegi. And that's why our focus on the self-assessment is also. Incentivize, yes, gold and silver quality certifications. Already we have the incentivized process, and with the Quality Council of India is totally online process is there. If you say the bronze quality certification, already Deputy CEO sir is already say that it's launched in the August 2019. The bronze quality certification is just a pre-entry level certification for the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. Previously, the bronze quality certification is only for the impaneled hospital, but now the NHA also have the policy that non-impaneled hospitals also take the bronze quality certification. And after taking the bronze quality certification, they will directly impaneled with the Ayushman Bharat if they need. If they don't need, they will accept the bronze quality certification. If they need, they will impanel directly also. The important things for the bronze quality certificate is totally user-friendly, comprehensive, evidence-based, and digital certifications with the objectives and balance. We know that over 75% facility is the small healthcare facilities. And that's why the bronze quality certification is the basic minimum requirement for the quality certifications. If you see the who is the entitled for the bronze quality certifications, bronze quality certification, all the impaneled or non-impaneled go for the bronze quality certification if they do not have any accreditation or certifications from the NQAS, NABH or JCIs. It's the basic quality certification which have the 53 standards and 182 means of verifications. The process is also very simple. You go for the registration portal, then the application submissions and fees submissions. Fees is also very minimum. If you see the 0 to 50 bedded, 51 to 100 bedded, 100 to 200 bedded, 200 to 500 bedded, and 1,000 or more. The minimum fees is 12,000 up to the more than 1,000 bedded fees is only 30,000. So fees is also very minimum. The desktop assessment applications, the main focus on the self-assessment, because if your self-assessment is best and give the evidence according to the record review, according to the staff interview, according to the patient interview, and according to the clinical practices, if you give the evidence properly, then your desktop assessment is completed by the expert assessors from the Quality Council of India and NABH. If your desktop assessment is completed, your NCs reply, if the first NC is reply, then it's okay. If you're not reply properly, then second NC is coming. If you complete the second NC reply, the on-site assessment is done by the qualified assessors. And after the on-site assessment successfully, your certification is coming within 7 days. It's totally online process. If your mail is finalized, your certification come on the mail. So it's totally digital form. And if you are well prepared, you will get this certificate within 28 days, the fastest certifications for the quality certifications. For the non-impaneled hospitals, you go for the websites and register your hospitals. According to the registers, you send, give the pay, fees, then the self-assessment. Again, the self-assessment, the desktop assessment done by the qualified assessors. After the desktop assessment, the on-site assessment. And if you're successful on-site assessment, you get the certification on your mail ID, registered mail ID. And it's also take the 25 days if you are well prepared. For the silver and gold quality certification, silver and gold quality certification is just a synonymous of the NABH or NQAS or JCI accredited hospitals. It's just a name changers. Like the silver quality certification, if your hospital is already NABH entry level certified, NABH national level certified in some of the departments, go for the silver quality certifications. Same for the gold quality certification. If your hospital is NABH fully accredited, JCI accredited or NQAS national level certificated for the all applicable department, which is sanctioned by the state, you go for the gold quality certifications. The process in the gold quality certification is the same, because for the silver and gold quality certification, only the impaneled hospitals go for the silver and gold quality certifications. The process, you log in into your HEM portals, then self-assessment. After self-assessment, desktop assessment is completed by the qualified assessors from the QCI and NABH. If the successful desktop assessment, you get your certification on registered mail ID. And if your preparation is well, then you will get this certification within 15 days. So it's a very online, transparent, and everything is there. And you get, and there will be no fees in the silver and gold quality certifications. How to achieve gold and quality, silver quality certification? If you think for this, when I say for the gold quality certification, if your hospital is impaneled with Ayushman Bharat and you have the NABH full accreditation, JCI accreditation or NQAS national level certification, all the department which is sanctioned by your state, they go for the gold quality certifications through the portals, registered in the portals, then the self-assessment application done, application desktop assessment is completed, and after desktop assessment, if you're successful, you get the certifications. The minimum question is there. This is our gold quality certifications, which have the scope of services and expiry date also. Same for the silver quality certifications. If your hospital is impaneled with the Ayushman Bharat, if your hospital is NABH entry labels, NQAS certified in some of the areas which is sanctioned by the state, go for the silver quality certification. The process of the silver quality certification and the gold quality certification is the same. Registers on the portals, answer give the ABPMJ specific questions, then the document verifications by the desktop assessment by the qualified assessors, and certification of your desktop assessment is successful, then certification go to your registered mail IDs. This is the quality certification of the silver. Just color is changed, gold for the gold quality certification, silver change the silver quality certifications, and bronze color for the bronze quality certification with the scope of services and validity and expiry date. You see the gold and silver quality certification, the question for the silver and gold quality certification is the same. The part is two. One is the ABPMJ specific questions, about 25 ABPMJ specific question is there. And another is the quality audit checklist 20, because your hospital is already NABH entry level or NQAS certified or NABH full accreditation or JCI accreditation. That's why we need the quality audit checklist. And this is only for the self-assessment toolkit. Because when we say for the quality culture, I think self-assessment is the best assessment for improve the quality culture. And that's why we need the quality audit checklist every month, which have only the 20 questions and which create the quality culture in your hospitals also. The question of the ABPMJ silver quality certification is very basic questions. Because when your hospital is impaneled with the Ayushman Bharat, we thinking that your hospital is work very good for the Ayushman Bharat. And that's why we see that your scope of services for the Ayushman Bharat is clearly defined or displayed in the local language with the prominent areas or not. Your scope of services in the local languages also or in the bilingual language, your staff is aware the scope of services, your dedicated kiosk is properly functional or not with your dedicated team, your Arogya Mit is well trained in the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojanas and duties of the Arogya Mitras. The other is important, the Arogya Mitra well equipped with the computers, with the babe check, with the fingertips and other things. And your hospital dedicated team is there. If your hospital is dedicated, doctors is also there for the ABPMJ. If your administrative staff is there for the ABPMJ, and then you give the evidence with that role and responsibilities of the doctors, administrative staff and Arogya Mitra. And if you give put the evidence online, then the desktop assessment is done. After the desktop assessment, if successful, you get the certifications also. The same if your scientific IEC, because when we see for the IEC, IEC is very important things. Some person is think that information enter in the corner. Most of the information is enter in the corner, but IEC is actually the information, education and communication material. It should be displayed properly. It should be displayed in the prominent area. It should be displayed in the local language. So maximum persons are know that this is the IC materials. Or your kiosk, because sometimes we thinking, we see that your kiosk in, just in the corners, but it should be in the prominent area where the everything is visible with the IC material, with the scope of services. Camping is also very important. That are you camping for the ABPMJ? When your hospital is impaneled with the ABPMJ, we thinking that your hospital function for the ABPMJ services. And that's why the camping is needed. Your hospital is camping or not, awareness generate or not, but this evidence, if you put on online, then we desktop assessment. And finally, we thinking for the certification, the map of your hospital, manpower and human resource. When you say that scope of services, identify the scope of services for the ABPMJ, we will identify that are you have the manpower properly or not? Are you have the human resource properly or not? So that you are mapping manpowers according to your scope of services. The hospital maintains proper medical record. Proper medical record is also very important things, that your OPD slips, your registration, your discharge summaries, your investigation report, and your feedback also for the patients and others. So your proper medical record is there and CLOM format is also there. The question is very basic questions, which is very important for the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana awareness and improve the qualities. The claim process, are you have the proper claim process or not? The beneficiaries charges extra money or not? As you know that Ayushman Bharat is totally free. So the question is, some question is just critical, that are you have charge or not? Your developed staff members trained the checklist is there, question is there. If you fill these questions and give as evidence that your staff is trained the HEM, your staff is trained the TMS, and your staff is trained on the BIS or not. So you give the evidence with the training, with the checklist, with the feedback, with the agenda of the trainings, then we take the successful desktop assessment. The other question is also the medical record of the referral of the beneficiaries. Referral should be a bi-directional. If you have the proper registers, bi-directional, you refer the patients and the patient is reached or not. And what is the outcomes for the patients which is referred by you? And your basic information is that the number of the Ayushman Bharat beneficiaries you take within the 6 months, just you give the number. IPD registrations within 6 months, just you give the numbers. And that is our hospital collect feedbacks during the discharge summary by the Ayushman Bharat beneficiaries and the quality audit checklist. Quality audit checklist, which have the 25 questions, which create the quality cultures. The last 25 questions is the screenshot that you filter your quality audit checklist and complete and submit. Then you take the screenshot and give as a evidence in 25 questions that you have the quality audit checklist and you filled regularly on the quality audit checklist. If you see the quality audit checklist is only for the continuous quality improvement programs. Because your hospital is already NABH entry level or NABH full accredited or JCI or NQAS accreditations. But we need that if your assessment is coming, you are well prepared. But are you prepared in every month properly? Are your culture is proper? And that's why only the basic 20 question is there, which is mainly focused on the process, which is mainly focused on the patient safety, which is also focused on the staff safety, and which is also focused on your hospital credibilities. And it's just an assessment tools through the direct observations, through the patient interview, by the staff interview, and by the record reviews. According to you give the evidence. If you don't have the evidence, you compliance zero. If you have the partial evidence, then you 5 marks. If you have the fully evidence, then you give the 10 marks. The impaneled hospitals have to perform online self-assessment. And we already say that self-assessment is the best assessment for the improvement. That's why the self-assessment create quality cultures. If you see the quality cultures audit checklist, they are the basic information like the service which is provided by the ABPM's impaneled hospital is prominently displayed or not. It's prominently in the local language or not. The hospital display IC material proper for the Ayushman Bharat is display or not. Your initial assessment, when we say for the initial assessment, are your initial assessment is signed by the doctors in 24 hours, within 24 hours, sign, name, time, date is available or not. If your diagnostic laboratories that are turnaround times for the diagnostic laboratory is not, critical time alert is there is not. If your cardiopulmonary resuscitation system, the mock drills is conducted or not, or your pictorial CPR pictorials display in the prominent area or not. So they are the basic question which is very important for the patient safeties and for the continuous quality improvement. Just like the anesthesia component, like your anesthesia record is proper or not, respiratory rate, blood pressures, oxygen saturations, airway securities, patents and others. Same thing for the informed consent, that your informed consent is in the local language. It's involved the risk involvement, benefits, alternative source, and by the concerned doctors is available or not. WHO checklist is also very important because the very important for prevent the wrong site, wrong patient, and wrong surgeries. So you follow the WHO checklist properly or not. The document procedure for the management of the medications, because the management medication is there. So we thinking that your management of medication is proper or not, sound alike, look alike medications, high risk medications is properly stored or separately or not, and high risk medication is the lock and key or not. The verification of the dose, route, time or expiry date is before you give administration of the medications. So it's also very important. The basic questions, which is administration of medicines, your adverse drug events is also there or not. So the adverse drug events is there. The hospital infection control committees, that you have the hospital infection control committee, but is it functional or not? So it's a functional or not. The healthcare provider is easily hand washing facilities. When we say for the hand washing practices, because we know over 85% infection is controlled by the hand washing properly. So your hand washing facility is proper or not, and it display in the all patient care area or not. The CERT members is provided the adequate, appropriate pre and post exposure. And nowadays, due to the corona, it's COVID, it's very important that yourself, post exposure prophylaxis and personal protective equipment is also very important. Use of the biomedical waste management is also very important. Your biomedical waste management is properly or not. The legal license, all the applicable legal license is updated or not updated with the self-exit plan. Because fire, one is the important things, your mock drill is proper or not, and fire exit plan is proper or not. The medical professes, credential and privileges of the medical professionals with the qualification, training, and registration, and up-to-date chronological detail of the patient's medical record. So these are the 20 questions which is in the quality audit checklist and which create the quality cultures. And after to complete this quality audit checklist, you take your screenshot and put evidence in the 25 questions of the ABPMJ Gold and Silver certifications. Same for the bronze quality certifications. The bronze quality certification is totally new certifications and which is very basic for the quality improvement programs. Which hospital which is not certified or accredited from the NQAS or NABH or JCIs is go for the bronze quality certifications. Previously, it's both only the empaneled hospital, but now the non-empaneled hospitals also go for the bronze quality certification. And after you get the bronze quality certification, you will directly apply for the ABPMJ and you will empanel directly through the bronze quality certification to the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. The process is already I described, the registration portals, SERP assessment, fees, desktop assessment, then the on-site assessment. In the bronze quality certification, the on-site assessment is also one extra process. In the silver and gold quality certification, there will be no on-site assessment, only then the desktop assessment, because in the gold and silver quality certification, already NABH assessment is done, NQAS assessment is already done, and JCI accreditation assessment is also done. So there will be no on-site assessment in silver and gold. And after the on-site assessment, you get the certification on your registered email ID if your on-site assessment is successful. Same for the non-empaneled hospital, it's already described. The benefit for the bronze quality certification, but the important things, when we say for the quality, quality need the cultures. And that's why the additional support to create the quality culture. It's a basic minimum requirement. So it's additional report the quality culture. The nationwide recognized, as our Deputy CSR is already said, that your bronze quality certification or any quality certification, we will recognize in each and state level or national levels or district levels on the 26th January and 15th August. And increase credibility to the health providers. If you provide the quality services, your hospital credibility will increase, your healthcare provider credibility is also increased. The patient safety is also very important part for the quality cultures. And that's why the patient safety for the bronze quality certification is also important things. If you see the how many standard and means of verifications, the chapter is only the 5 chapter in the bronze quality certification. First is the key inputs, another the clinical services, support services, patient care services, and health outcomes. And if you see the total 53 standards and 182 means of verifications. If you see the key input just related to the infrastructure, that your hospital environment proper or not, environment related to the infrastructure, environment related to the instrument equipment, environment related to the trainings, visitors and the staffs, your ambulance services, its functional or not, at the proper place or not, your physical barrier for, especially for the disabled patient, that your environment is disabled friendly or not, your outdoor patient for the indoor, the well lit or well ventilated or not, the staff or basic amenities like the toilets, drinking water facilities for the staff and visitors is available or not, and the credentiality of our staff, our doctors and our staff for the nursing staff and others, and the legal statutory requirements is available or not, the instrument equipment according to your scope of service is available or not, and your fire detection, because fire is very important things. So your fire detections, fire equipment, instrument, and fire safety note is available note. And when we say for the CPR, because CPR is very important things, so that you properly, your basic life supports training is there or not, ACLS training is there or not, and it's available in the critical care area, display or not. The annual training programs of your staff is available note accordingly. The second chapter related to the clinical service. If your input is good, then the clinical service is mainly for the process related. Like your OPD, IPD patients, is privacy maintained or not? your outdoor services, which the diagnostic services is available according to your scope of services. If your diagnostic service is not available, then are you out of MOU sign? Your blood bank services, your ICU services, your OT complex, lookalike sounder like medications, identification, safe dispensing, administration of high-risk medications, antibiotic policies, operation, preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative areas, and anesthesia, just like a pre-anesthesia, post-anesthesia, and internal anesthesia plans documented properly or not. Then the supportive services, as for the supportive services, like the security services, like the housekeeping services, like your biomedical waste services, like your laundry services, like your dietary services, ambulance, mortuary, and especially the sexual harassment or grievance services available or not. So these are the supportive services. For the patient care services, as you know that your proper signage is available or not, the proper language is proper or not, display in the prominent area is not, or emergency department is very important, which is emergency department is signed by the medical staffs is properly or not. And the hospital should advise the administration of the patient and the general consent, informed consent, which is taken for the patient care area and for the educations, the patient right and responsibility is followed or not, educations for the patients and medical record is properly or not. When we say last chapter is the health outcome, if your input is good, if your clinical services is good, if your other services, outside services is good, if your patient care area is good, outcome is coming. So outcomes related to the OPD, related to the IPD, related to the mortality rate, related to the average length of stay, related to the infection control practices, the urinary tract infection, bloodstream, ventilator associated pneumonia, and transfusion reaction, bed occupancy, percentage of the patient satisfaction, employee satisfaction, waiting times, and report of the threat for security, and report of the needle stick injuries. So outcome indicators, which also monitors in the bronze quality certifications. If you see the progress of the bronze quality certification, which is already described by our deputy CEO, if you see, we have the proper quality certification dashboard, the how many application is coming, how many hospital registers, how many application in the desktop assessment, how many application in the self assessment, how many application in the first desktop assessment, and how many application in the second desktop assessment, and how many hospital are already accredited. Till now, 141 total hospital is already accredited, 64 is gold, 67 is silver, and 10 is already bronze quality certifications hospitals. If you see more detail, the each and every link is there for the, and all the guidelines is totally pictorious guideline is available, which is very user friendly, and there will be no language barriers. It's totally pictorious guideline, so easy to understand and easy to implement bronze quality certification, silver quality certification, and gold quality certification in your hospitals. So thank you very much. Thanks to NABH and QSCI again for giving these opportunities.
Dr. Meena sir, we love you because you speak from dil se, and yes. Nobody else could have made this highly technical talk so user-friendly, so easy to understand. So thank you so much for taking your time to give all our audience a wonderful introduction and how easy it is to get empaneled, at least in the bronze manner. And I totally agree that a self-assessment audit is the best way to adhere, to start on a quality journey, to progress on a quality journey, and proceed on a quality journey. And without quality, there is nothing. I mean, so that is the foundation of all healthcare activities. And before we take questions from you, and we would want you to stay around for the last question and answer round. So yeah. Let me introduce Ms. Neeta Anand, who's not only additional director with NABH for past 3 years, a very, very hardworking officer, but with a rich experience of more than 10 years. She is an MBA in hospital administration. She is very, very well-versed with all schemes of NABH, and she's currently the co-convener of all our communities also, so which is a very responsible. So she'll be telling us about one very important certification scheme of NABH, which is analogous to silver certification of NHA, which is the entry-level certification. It has also earlier been labeled as HOPE scheme. I mean, HOPE scheme, it's very popular. That is our portal name, which we call the hospital online platform for entry level certification. So this is for all those hospitals who wish to start on a quality journey in a structured manner. Our standards were first brought out in 2014. And since then, there are currently nearly 6,000 people who have touched us in some area or another. But currently certified are about 27. I think Neeta will give us the correct, what are the figures. But this massive number is day by day increasing. And we are trying to make the process for them also very, very simplified and easy. And all of those who are wishing to join us as an entry-level certified scheme must keep visiting our website for new resources, new frequently asked questions, and new guidance on how easy it is to enter it into an entry-level certification scheme and thereby get automatically empaneled if they so into the PM Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. So that is a wonderful scheme. So Neeta, are you there? You can take over now.
Sir. Yeah. Please. Sure. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, CEO sir, for the beautiful introduction you have given. Thank you so much. Namaskar. I am Neeta. I am serving as assistant director in MEBH. The topic of today's discussion has been given to us as importance of quality certification in changing the culture of healthcare. We undergone, we have just now seen about QCI and NABH. QCI is an autonomous body set up by Government of India to establish and operate accreditation structure in our country. And we, NABH, we are a constituent board of Quality Council of India. The setup was an association with the Government of India and Indian healthcare industry, wherein we are catering to the needs of consumers and setting the standards for progress of the health industry. We are also supported by all stakeholders and having full functional autonomy in its operation. The basic activities, our CEO sir has already briefed about it, so I'll just skip these slides. We are serving for accreditation, certification, empanelment, and as of now, we have more than 5,400 accreditations and certifications with more than 2,800 empanelments. Now coming to the entry-level standards, wherein we are looking to improve the quality of healthcare by improvising the standards of entry-level, which are achievable, which are meant to focus over the hospitals, which are lesser or smaller in number, having lesser infrastructure. So this entire concept of entry-level standards started in the year 2014 with an aim to provide a step-by-step staged approach to quality improvement. And the basic idea to start it was to encourage HCOs. HCOs here stand for healthcare organizations, to encourage the hospitals to join the quality journey. It is more achievable for the hospitals joining the quality improvement and lesser expensive. I'll compare the fees of the annual fees at the end of my slides, wherein we'll come to see that the fees have been kept lesser deliberately in order to encourage the hospitals to participate more and more. These are the benefits of certification highlighted. It has basically been divided into four categories, which are patient, healthcare organization, healthcare staff, and regulatory body. For the patients, they are the biggest beneficiaries. The certification, because the process of certification involves many steps, wherein there have processes changes, there are infrastructural changes. So on the part of patients, when the patient is visiting a certified hospital, it has resulted into high quality of care and patient safety. That is attributed to the fact that the standards have been prepared, taking into consideration the patient safety point. And when a hospital is certified, it ensures that all those points have been checked. And that is why we say that on the part of patients, certification has resulted in high quality of care and patient safety. Healthcare organization, how a certificate has benefited a healthcare organization or any hospital, It has enabled to demonstrate commitment to quality care and provide opportunity to the healthcare. How? I'll explain this. Whenever an assessment has been done and a hospital has been granted certification, that means the hospital has undergone assessment on various levels, on the chapters, on the standards given, and has demonstrated an effective implementation, and then only that hospital has been certified. So when a hospital is certified, it is leading to the benchmark with the best. On the part of healthcare staff, which can include doctors, nurses, paramedical staff, and even the housekeeping staff, there are the standards related with infection control practices, with the credentialing privileging, which ensures that the patients are being taken care into the right hand, which ensures that the hospital is taking care of their staff as well in terms of their immunization, vaccinations, in terms of their healthcare needs. So when the certification has been granted, it has covered the healthcare staff also. Now comes the regulatory bodies. The certification provides an objective system of empanelment by insurance and other third parties. It provides access to reliable and certified information on facilities, infrastructure, and level of healthcare. There are many regulatory bodies which enable, and when a hospital is certified, it helps in achieving that. Now coming to how were these interlevel certification standards developed. As I explained, these standards, the interlevel standards, are easy to achieve, as in the competency level, or see, we can say they are easy in terms of implementation. With the due progression of time, it was noted that large number of hospitals and small healthcare organizations, they were facing challenges and difficulties in implementing complete NABH accreditation. So these standards were made taking into consideration infrastructure, manpower, and monetary constraints. There are many hospitals in our country which are not having a lot of resources wherein they can have extraordinary manpower or extraordinary infrastructure. So taking into consideration those constraints, and to encourage people to come and apply more and more, move towards the certification, to at least start building the quality processes, these entry-level standards were started. This entry-level certification process was done in consultation with various stakeholders in the entire country as a stepping stone for enhancing the quality of patient care and safety, so that more and more hospitals are encouraged to come forward and progressively they can move towards the next step in the accreditation. So first starting with entry level, and then progressively with the passage of time, improving in their infrastructure and their staff, they can move on. Now coming to the entry level certification, from NABH, we accept the applications over HOPE portal, which stands for Healthcare Organizations Platform for Entry-Level Certification. This was launched in collaboration with QCI and HOPE, NABH, wherein HOPE is a portal and app which facilitates the certification process of healthcare organizations. This is a complete paperless and totally online system which maintains transparency and communication with the hospital. This is a process of, we can say, a complete process wherein how the assessment is conducted. For flowchart mentioned here is for desktop assessment. In HOPE portal, there are two assessments. One is desktop and then is the on-site. So this flowchart is of the desktop assessment, wherein I'll explain this process so that any hospital who is willing to apply can understand this. This is a registration on HOPE portal. Once the hospital has registered, a temporary application number will be given to that hospital. The information document submission on web portal and mobile application, the hospital will get the email ID and password to log in, and then the hospital can upload the document. I'll go into details on how the hospital can move about it. Then it's the fee submission, and once the fee is submitted, a permanent application number will be generated. This temporary application number will get converted into permanent application number once all these processes are complete. So once the application has been received with NABH, the desktop assessment will be conducted. In the desktop assessment, if there are certain non-compliances found out by assessor, NC, non-compliance, will be raised. This non-compliance will be forwarded to ACO, hospital. Here, HCU is a healthcare organization, and HCU is a small healthcare organization. This NC closure, after this NC closure, the hospital will submit the closure, and it is submitted back to the assessor for review. If the assessor has reviewed it, finally, it will go for on-site assessment. If the hospital has assessor has not reviewed it, then again, NC closures will be provided twice. The options to submit closures will be provided to the hospital. And further, after final acceptance, it will come through date allotment for on-site assessment. But if after two times also, the NC has been rejected, the hospital will not be able to apply, go for on-site assessment. Now, this is the process flow for on-site assessment. Once the desktop assessment is clear, the on-site assessment will start this way. It will be done when the assessor physically visits the hospital. As of now, there are difficulties right now, but this is the process of on-site assessment. Now, coming to the details of desktop assessment, what all details the hospital requires to fill, general information. This section covers basic information of the hospital and is divided into categories of contact details and hospital information. As we can understand from the name itself, contact details means the name of the hospital, address, the person responsible for coordinating. This comes very important because we need a single point of contact. That person's email ID and mobile number has to be fed into the application so that if there is any communication to be done, it will be done with that particular person. The hospital, by filling the form, will need to fill this. The other details of hospital information, such as the where the hospital is registered with the local authority, what is the registration date, what is the type of ownership, private, public, trust, like that. So it is there in the system, in the application. The hospital just needs to pick and select from there. This is an important section, statutory compliances. It is very important that all the licenses have to be uploaded in the application, which are current and valid. The licenses, if matured, the hospital needs to upload the renewal application also. But this is important that for any assessment before the hospital is going, the hospital should check that all the applicable licenses are available and uploaded in the current and valid situation. There are many places where the hospital has an MOU of services. For smaller hospitals, for certain great bigger services such as MRI, CT, if some smaller hospital has done some MRI agreement or some association with any other nearby center, in those cases, they should upload the MOU as well. The MOU should be with the outsourced services, and it should be valid and very clear, and the terms and conditions should be mentioned. That should also be uploaded. And the hospital is staffing, there is a section which covers the name, designation, qualification, degrees of the staff, registration, number, working departments, etc. It is divided into the categories of medical officers, nurses, paramedical staff, admin and support staff. All these categories have to be filled, wherein the registration number of the staff is mandatory to be mentioned. Now we come to the clinical services details. This section covers the type of clinical services in which the hospital needs to give the OPD and IPD data, the average occupancy rate, ICU data, scope of services, the doctor's association with the hospital as full-time, part-time, visiting, and then the 10 most frequent clinical services where admissions take place, the most frequent diagnosis, the most frequent surgical procedures, and the type of sterilization most used in the hospital. By filling all these details in the application, it helps the assessor to come up to the conclusion of what all is the scope hospital is serving. The physical infrastructure, bed strength. Under bed strength, it is important to mention the differentiation vis-a-vis the category. For example, the number of beds in emergency, ward, ICU, general, like that. It is there in the application. The hospital just needs to fill up the data there. the services offered, for example, the location of the services in the hospital, what all departments are there in the hospital, the laboratory services, which all facilities are being provided by the hospital, diagnostic imaging, which all facilities are again being provided under diagnostic services, bone densitometry, CT, X-ray, like that. And we have a section of others also in which the remaining services can be fed. To make it easier for the hospital, all these are already fed in the system. The only the hospital needs to understand and then click it from the drop-downs and then start filling it. This is another section while filling the form the hospital will come across, which is the quality improvement process in which these name of the committee or coordinator name to be mentioned. The registration, admission, and billing process, which focuses on parameters for patient identification, rights and responsibilities, and documentation of registration and admission of patients. About patient and family education, this is very important that the patient and family are educated, and there is a different one complete chapter which deals about it in NEDH, wherein the education has been given a lot of emphasis. Patient-related processes, nursing care processes, medication management, and human resource training. These all are covered into the chapters of NEDH, and which there are different headings under which there are medication management, how they should be stored, how the high-risk medication should be stored. Just Dr. Meena just mentioned about the storage of high-risk medication. Because when we have seen and the statistic numbers and the figures are there, which prove that lot of medication errors have led to the disaster or to the events which could have been stopped. There are many studies done and there are many publications over it. So there is a separate chapter given to medication management, wherein the storage, the dispensing of medication, look-alike, sound-alike, many things are there, which have to be given due importance and care. The last, but not the least, is human resource training, wherein the credentialing, privileging of staff, the staff who are well-trained or not, the staff who are training given on basic life support, the staff given training on fire safety, maybe clinical, maybe non-clinical, all sorts of training should be covered for the staff. And this comes under human resource training. Infection control, another important chapter, which focuses on hand hygiene, general cleanliness, standard precautions, personal protective equipment, occupational health hazards, biomedical waste, water testing, and many other things. This might seem in a smaller perspective to us, but when we go into details into infection control part, each and every corner of the hospital speaks about it. The management process, it seeks information regarding process of management for medication error and adverse drug reaction, handling and delivering of services of lab blood bank. There is a chapter which deals about the involvement of management and how the MOUs are maintained, about the decisions are taken, communicating the adverse reactions and all those things. The safety management, it requires photographs to be uploaded for the safety management. When I'll be coming into details of how the form has to be filled, there is a section wherein the hospitals can upload details by clicking pictures through their mobile. I'll come into that part. So all these parts wherein the photos are required, the hospitals can click from their mobile and upload. The record management, documents pertaining to medical records and fire extinguishers in the medical records, they are required to be maintained. The safety aspect has to be thoroughly seen overall the hospital. Now coming to the application form. Till now we have discussed that by and large what all the things which are required. And now when the hospital is willing to register over Hope Portal, how they should go about it. This is the website, www.hope.qcin.org. When we go over this page, when we type this link, this page will come. Here is a register tab. When we click over that, we receive a form which is hospital user registration form, something like this. The new application, the hospitals who are registering for the first time, they need to click over this form and submit it. The details here are mandatory, basic details like hospital name, email ID, the number, telephone number, who is the one person contact, which is SPOC, single point of contact. The address of the hospital, where is it stated, the state, PIN code, the number of sanctioned beds, like this. So when this complete form has been filled, a pop-up will come like this, that hospital has been successfully registered on HOPE portal. Password to login has been sent over the email ID what you have registered. So when that email ID, if you open, it will come like this, that the username and password to register further or to login into the application and continue the application process has been given. Using that user ID and login password, the hospital needs to login again. And here comes the home page, which will appear like this first after the registration. This is the dashboard, and here that person single point of contact name will be displayed towards the right side. Now the hospital can click over registration form and go ahead. When we click over the registration column, these are the basic tabs which were visible: general information, statutory compliance, hospital staffing, clinical services, physical infrastructure, quality improvement process, and documentation. So first is the general information. When we click over this general information tab, it will come like this. Name of the hospital, do patients stay overnight, like that basic details. And here is the contact details, plus find me. We can go on clicking over it and keep on adding it. Hospital information, we can go on clicking it. It will continue giving you new tabs. Now, we have two types of uploads here. We have web portal and mobile application documentation uploads. This is where the documents that required to be uploaded through web portal online will have upload any file icon next to them as highlighted, which is this one. And the documents which have to be uploaded through mobile application online, we'll have a view uploaded file like this, a view color icon in which you can find the picture like an eye is made, which will make the differences of mobile uploads and web uploads. Now, general information we had seen. The second tab is of statutory compliances. Again, statutory compliances, that starts with the registration, biomedical waste, MGP license, the fire, so the compliances related with fire and other statutory compliances, they have to be uploaded here. We can go on clicking here, plus, 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 and it will give the down boxes will start coming. And if the hospital is having any MOU services, those details also need to be uploaded here. That it is written, details of MOU of services outsourced. The third tab is hospital staffing. We discussed just now that under these tabs, we have general duty, nurses, paramedical, administrators. And here to the bottom of the page, we have the nurses details.
Yeah, Neeta. Neeta, I think we can quickly scroll through this because these are technical issues. No? Somebody has to,
Like this, we have another tab of clinical services. One important thing is that we need to click on saving. Here is a save option. We need to click on saving and then the final submit. But once the final submit button has been clicked, the hospital will not be able to make changes. So we need to be careful while pressing the final submit button. Saving can be done. Now, this is a key point to remember. It is compulsory to save the information on the desktop portal first before using the mobile application for further document uploads. The applicant can only log in once on either the desktop or the mobile application. They cannot use simultaneously both the apps. It is necessary to make sure that user is connected to an active internet connection while uploading the documents in mobile app so that the connectivity is not lost and whatever data has been uploaded, the duplication of effort should not be required. The details entered by applicants for registration on the HOPE website cannot be edited once the details are submitted. So we should be very careful while pressing the final submit button. This is a mobile app which will look like this. Here, wherever the mobile pictures are required, the hospital needs to click pictures and then they can upload it here like this way. The same, the steps to upload documents have been mentioned. And once uploaded, it is very important that the sync should be done. The syncing is once the mobile uploads have been done, there is a bottom an icon called sync mentioned, wherein the hospital needs to press it so that all the data is been synced between the desktop and the mobile app. Here it is sync.
Yes, I think the bottom line is that this is a very objective and transparent process where this is important. You can tell about the fees, then we can summarize.
this is the fees differentiation. The only difference is that the hospital needs to put on the fees for 2 years together. For HCO, the hospital is having more than 50 sanctioned beds. The fees is about 52,000 plus GST. And for a small healthcare organization where the hospital number of beds are less than 50, it is 21,000. The hospital needs to fill the application form, the fees, and then they will get the permanent registration number. This is the support given to the HCOs. So we always request the hospitals to go through the guidebook before start filling the application form, because the guidebook is downloadable from the website, which has complete details of the licenses asked and how the hospital can go about. That's all. The entry-level program, and any queries can be sent over any BH at anybh.co.
Correct. So thank you so much.
With this, I can conclude. Thank you so much.
Yeah. So I think this is a wonderful and very lucid presentation. And for all those who are not aware about, I'll just summarize in 2-3 lines. Basically, we have hospital accreditation standards, which are very comprehensive, covering each and every area of hospital in detail. For those hospitals and HCOs which wish to start on a quality journey, which are not very familiar with the quality standards, entry-level certification was devised, which is valid for 2 years. And which is automatically taken by NHA as a analogous to silver certification, as Dr. Meena has already informed us. So this is a very objective, very transparent, same pattern as our full hospital standards, but very easy to implement. So if you go through these standards, you will find that this is a objective, transparent, traceable, trackable process, which is completely online. You just have to keep on doing submit and upload documents as asked for. It is a very simple process. We are getting questions that what kind of policy, how much time. So if you do it properly, if you are doing all these things in a structured manner, if not, you can start today and start creating these things which are self-explanatory, and you can do it yourself. And we are we'll very soon be uploading our updated frequently asked questions on our site. So it'll be easy for you, for all those people who are not familiar. So that is another small initiative on the part of NABH. But currently, there's a question for Dr. Meena, which says that are these certification important, mandatory for hospital to remain impaneled? Suppose somebody is enrolled under your NHA scheme, sir. So what happens if they lose their certification in between? So automatically they get disconnected with your program or what?
Yeah. Sir, there will be no mandatory.
Neeta, you can stop sharing your screen.
Yes. Hello.
Yes. Anji, yes. Tell me.
There will be no provision for mandatory, but in futures, the bronze quality certification should be mandatory for the impanelment. But nowadays, there will be no mandatories. Only first we create the quality cultures. Then after that, we will planning for the mandatory, and if your expiry date is coming, then we will thinking for the deem panel from Ayushman Bharat also.
But okay, so it's very clear that if somebody who's entry level certified, they get your certification, your empanelment based on NABH certification, and they lose that. And so it's important for them to maintain that quality. Correct?
Yes, sir. And
so it is very important to...
Yes, sir. Important thing is that if your silver and gold quality certification expiry date is same as per the NABH entry level or NABH certified hospital. If you don't update your certification, then your gold or silver certification is expired.
Okay. Wonderful. So, I think that's a very clear message to all to not dilute their standards further, and whatever program you are empaneled in, you must continue to strive better, because all these standards or all these certification standards which are there, they aim at a basic culture of patient safety, and that has to be maintained. They, like Neeta told us, they are very comprehensive. They go into all areas of patient culture where patient safety is there, patient rights and responsibilities are there, from facility management to human rights management to medication of management to infection control, which are also very relevant. So any hospital who wishes to start on this journey, they only have to log on to our site, enroll in the platform, start a culture and follow guidelines. It is as simple as that. Another question to Dr. Meena is that, is there any grievance mechanism for hospital in case they face any issues and cannot get in touch with state authorities? So what is your grievance mechanism, sir?
Sir, our grievance handling unit is also there at the state level and national levels. And you see already, our deputy CEO is already present, that grievance handling mechanism.
Yes.
We also identify the fraud mechanism and grievance in related to the qualities and others. Some hospitals FIRA is already done and some hospital is already doing penalties. So we have the strong grievance handling units is also there and fraud control units there.
Yeah, I think Dr. Vipul and now yourself also are saying, because I think as far as NABH is concerned or NHA is concerned, both are very positive programs. So our idea is not to create hindrances. These are voluntary programs. These are not mandatory. But anybody, any organization who wishes to join these programs has to come forward, and we very positively look after them and try to as much as aid them as possible. So that is another thing. One question, I think I'll take it, or Neeta, you can take that. We have been scheduled for entry level on-site assessment, but due to lockdown, it got cancelled. So yes, we apologize for that. Because of the restrictions in place, we could not carry on. Kindly let us know when on-site visits starting in Kerala. So this is just one point of reply that we NABH has initiated its entry level remote assessments. We have finalized the protocol and we'll soon be offering that to all hospitals, at starting with smaller to bigger hospitals, where we can attempt a remote assessment and take it to conclusion. So that is one area. So what are the timelines, Neeta? Can you just elaborate on timelines? How much time average it would take for one hospital to start with empanelment and get a certificate?
Sir, during the normal conditions, when the hospital applies over HOPE portal comparatively is a very faster process. As in, the hospital when applies over the application, everything is software driven there. So, excluding this present time of COVID, we have a target of finishing everything within 45 days. Wherein the hospital application process till the final completion. It depends, again, varies over the availability of assessors. At times, it becomes difficult for us to manage that huge load. Otherwise, the HOPE itself brings a very good platform for all the hospitals for a faster process. As for this present COVID time, of course, we are taking care of this present scenario, and there are measures in place to start the assessment again.
And there's one question, I think I'll take it, which is very, very relevant, which Ridhima has just posted, that are there any guidelines regarding formulation of SOPs for hospitals as required by NABH? So basically, all of the hospital owners and doctors must understand that we are not very prescriptive. We do not tell you to follow certain SOPs on a national level. You have to see your core domain areas, what kind of services you are providing, what is the scope of services of your hospital, and what is the catchment population you are catering to. So based on that, you are free to devise your own SOPs. So we are very, very generic. We are not prescriptive. Of course, certain checklist is there, self-assessment tool, as Dr. Meena has said, is there. And based on that, certain basic requirements are there, like statutory compliance and basic following, like fire NOC and other things, BMW. But we do not enter the other domain areas. Those SOPs, please, you are free to formulate and follow them. Our only insistence is that some SOP is there for to cater to all aspects. And these SOPs, you should follow very, very scrupulously what you have designed. Your staff should know, so that any scenario, patient safety is encouraged and you should continue to provide good standard services. I mean, not a case-to-case basis service, but good standard services, so that patient safety is encouraged also and quality culture is maintained also. Then there is one question, another question for Dr. Meena. Is there any difference in the incentive given on ABPM J certification by different states? I mean, is there any variations in the state-wise reimbursement?
Yes, sir. Because health is the state subject, so incentives are also a variation in the different states. But we will plan for the universal as per the NHA policies.
I think that's well said, because Dr. Vipul also was very, very categorical that now, I mean, with HVP 2.0, it's a continuing evolving scheme, and they are trying to plug all loopholes and taking it nationwide. So it's a wonderful scheme, I think. And very soon he also mentioned that he's planning to, NHA is planning to merge all state schemes, that's a final goal, into all one universal platform. So, that's a wonderful idea, actually. So thank you so much. That is, and one is applied for full accreditation on 1st April. Okay, 20. We will be assessed on 4th, on 5th edition. Yeah, so that, I think I'll just take that. Our implementation for plan for 5th edition, that is for full accreditation, is already on website. So had you applied, since you have applied before 30th June, option is for 4th. In case you wish to defer to 5th, that is also acceptable. Please, you can write to us on case-to-case basis. Otherwise, go through our website, nabh.co, for a comprehensive implementation plan. Also, a free copy of 5th hospital standards also. And please mail in your suggestions also. So I think we'll just have closing remarks from Dr. Meena and Neeta, and then because I think this has been a very successful, we have had a good reach, and we will maintain this webinar on our site also, your presentations also on our site for all those who wish to look at it later, and your frequently asked question along with our frequently asked questions. So we are building that resource material. So Dr. Meena, your closing remarks on the importance of quality certification in any crisis and importance of ABPMJ Yojana, and closing remarks to all who are listening or will listen later.
Yes, sir. First of all, I heartily thanks to NABH and the Quality Council of India for organizing this wonderful events. The important things, I humble request to all our healthcare organizations, because we need quality cultures. And nowadays, the COVID is there, the infectious disease is there. So especially for the quality cultures, we need some certification. And I think, sir, the NABH entry level and bronze quality certification, two certification is a very well-defined, digitalized, paperless, on-site assessment, transparent. I think they both certificate is very good to implement in tier 2 and tier 3 cities also. So for the quality cultures, it's a very needed that you follow the bronze quality certification or entry level, NABH entry levels. And the important thing is the self-assessment. I am again and again say that self-assessment is the best assessment for the improvement. You follow the self-assessment and the guidelines for the bronze and NABH entry level and NABH pulse nowadays very well defined. And they're easy to understand by the self-assessment. So self-assessment is also very important things. And last but not least, quality is the teamwork. Without teamwork, you never achieve the quality. And related to the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, I think this is the one of the largest public health insurance scheme in the world. And the benefit for the beneficiaries, you know that about 1 crore beneficiaries take the benefits from this Ayushman Bharat Yojana. And you know that number of the poor families in there in the India. And now we are also planning for the merge all the state scheme and other central schemes in the Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana. So the goal of our honorable Prime Minister that provide universal health coverage, I think this will be achieved soon. So thank you very much, sir.
Wonderful. I think that there's nothing better than highlighting that this is a grand scheme covering nearly our 40% of population, 50 crore beneficiaries ultimately aiming for. It is something to be counted for in the larger interest of people, and our huge step towards the USC, the Universal Health Coverage Declaration, which we are part of. Neeta, your closing comments on entry level and NABH importance and this thing?
First of all, very thankful to sir for giving this opportunity to speak over the entry-level certification program. The entry-level certification is one program in which the hospital can surely go for it, can apply for it. And my only request is to go with the guidebook first before application. The standards are achievable, doable, and it is very easy because the form of over portal has been designed in a very stepwise manner. the hospitals will not find it difficult, and it is important to move towards quality and the journey to gain the quality within the healthcare. It is very doable and achievable. And with this, I would like to conclude. Thank you so much, sir.
I think that's wonderful. And also for all, we already have a call center running, and which is still running during the COVID. So all those, for all those technical queries, for handholding, whatever, you can just call them. So this is a functional call center. Our website is very comprehensive. For any guidance, please feel free to write to us also. So this is a good process. And once again, I would like to praise on record our appreciation for Dr. Vipul Agarwal, IPS, Deputy CEO of NHA, Dr. J.L. Meena, General Manager of NHA, and our friend, because he's the principal assessor for NABH also, Neeta. Once again, thank you to you and all those listeners who have joined us today, and the entire NHA and QCI team, which has been helping us. Ridhima is there, and from the IT division, Ranvijay ji, Saurabh Sakit, Alok Jain ji. So all these wonderful people brought us closer to a whole lot of people. I've been told that 1500 plus people logged in to see this, and we will place it, all the FAQs and everything on the site for all of you to visit again and learn from their messages. So thank you so much. We look forward to connect with you sooner. Meanwhile, please continue to follow guidance and guidelines and stay safe. And keep visiting our website, nabh.co, for more updates. Thank you so much. Namaskar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Namaskar. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks to all participants also.
Thank you.